New Madrid's killer fault is about to strike again. The earthquake psychosis is back in the USA, but this time, it's not about the long-awaited big one that's supposed to devastate sunny California sooner or later, or the really big one that could unleash havoc in the Cascadia anytime now. This time, fears are concentrated in a vast area of the central eastern USA, stretching along the borders of Arkansas, Missouri, Tennessee, and southern Illinois, where intense seismic activity has been recorded for some time, characterized by a long series of small magnitude tremors. These tremors originate precisely along the so-called New Madrid seismic zone, which in the early 19th century was the site of a series of devastating earthquakes so severe that they even managed to reverse the flow of the Mississippi River for a stretch. Many metropolises are currently located in the at-risk zone, from Memphis to St. Louis, and the region has been defined as the most threatening fault line among all those east of the Rocky Mountains. What's that? You didn't know anything about it? Well, that doesn't surprise us. The earthquakes of two centuries ago affected regions that were so sparsely populated at that time that they were soon forgotten. Their memory, contrary to much more celebrated seismic locations, especially by the film industry, remains only in the hidden chronicles of the time. However, the danger is still very real, and when another tremor shakes that territory, it will likely find a community completely unprepared for the emergency. If you want to learn more about the tragic events of those distant days, and what will happen soon, all you have to do is keep following this exceptional video, as always offered by the Insane Curiosity Channel. Of course, always remembering that, on the same topic, we've produced two others, precisely those about the earthquake that will devastate the Cascadia and Yellowstone regions in the future. Okay, but for now, follow us, and let's find out together what happened in New Madrid in the winter of many years ago. In December of 1811, an invisible force gripped the central Mississippi Valley and didn't let go for weeks. A series of major earthquakes caused the riverbed to rise and fall as if it were a restless sea. On February 7, 1812, just upstream of New Madrid, Missouri, the earth was deformed to the point where the mighty Mississippi began to flow north instead of south. That event was the culmination of a period of terror known as the New Madrid earthquakes. On December 16, 1811, at 2 in the morning, the first earthquake struck what is now the southern tip of Missouri. Both country and city dwellers woke up to furniture bouncing and porcelain dishes shattering. Houses were shifting off their foundations. People poured into the streets and stayed there, trembling from the cold and the tremors. Their once quiet and safe homes had suddenly become dangerous. In the hours before dawn, the earth kept trembling, albeit with less intensity. Around 7 o'clock, there was another violent jolt. Then around 11, an even stronger one occurred. Chasms opened up in the ground, spewing forth torrents of mud, water, and coal. Sulfurous gas emissions from underground contaminated the air with their foul odor. Eyewitnesses observed thousands of birds fleeing the area in a frenzy. When the shaking finally subsided, Little Prairie, a town in Missouri, lay in ruins. Minor tremors continued until January of 1812. On the morning of January 23rd, around 9, another strong earthquake struck, sowing terror. Point Pleasant, already battered, was near the epicenter, and its inhabitants fled. When summer turned in February, they realized not only was the town destroyed, but there was no trace left of it. Due to the earthquake on January 23rd, Point Pleasant and the ground it stood on had been hurled into the Mississippi. But it wasn't over yet. The disaster continued to ravage the region. On February 7th, 1812, before dawn, the restless sleep of the area's inhabitants was once again interrupted by tremendous seismic waves. The epicenter was beneath them. This earthquake, more violent than all the previous ones, was so strong that in Cincinnati, Ohio, 650 kilometers away, it knocked down chimneys. In Boston, Massachusetts, 1,600 kilometers away, it rang the bells. Farther north in Montreal, Canada, the noise of trembling plates and saucers on tables could be heard. A man from Kentucky living 130 kilometers away from the epicenter wrote in his diary, "If we don't get out of here, the earth will swallow us alive." However, the earthquake's fury was particularly unleashed on the river city of New Madrid. The tremors of 1811 had already severely damaged the small town, killing several inhabitants and forcing most survivors to leave. The shock of February 11th delivered the final blow. When the earthquake hit, the remaining people fled, barely in time. The elevated bank on which the city stood crumbled and slid into the Mississippi, where the turbulent waters swept away the boards, bricks, and stones of New Madrid. In a short time, there was no trace left of the city. The earthquakes caused temporary waterfalls along the river near New Madrid, capsizing dozens of boats. The tremor on February 7th lifted and sank the ground, forcing the flow of the Mississippi to reverse. Enormous chasms opened up under the river, creating whirlpools that sucked in other boats. The earthquakes altered the river's course, flooding cities and farmland. They also diverted the waters, giving rise to Real Foot Lake in Tennessee, which did not exist before 1812. The earthquake was so powerful that within 3 minutes, seismic waves reached Charleston, Washington, and Boston. The shaking lasted for 15 minutes, and needless to say, even the sturdiest brick and stone houses crumbled to their foundations for miles around. St. Louis and Louisville suffered severe damage. Aftershocks hammered the country for days. Out of a population of about 15,000 inhabitants in the affected area, more than 1,000 people perished and at least 5,000 found themselves homeless. Are you perhaps thinking that the loss of life wasn't that terrible compared to the recent carnage in Haiti and Turkey? Well, you'll change your mind when you consider that, at that time, the population density was one person per square kilometer. Besides the loss of human lives, there was also damage to structures. 5 settlements, a military fort, and countless Indian villages vanished from the face of the earth. In many places, the ground was torn open and then covered with sand, boils, fissures, and cracks. Dead trees were everywhere. Swamps were lifted and dried out, while good grazing and farming land were submerged by new enormous lakes. The still young United States had never experienced a disaster of such magnitude. It's impossible to establish the exact magnitude of these earthquakes since seismographs didn't exist in 1812. Scientists estimate that at least 3 of the New Madrid earthquakes measured on the Richter scale would have had a magnitude greater than 8. These are the most intense earthquakes ever observed in the continental United States, and globally, they are among the strongest ever recorded. Hey guys, just a moment before we continue. Be sure to join the Insane Curiosity channel. Click on the bell, you will help us to make products of even higher quality. Okay, that's a quick summary of what happened more than 2 centuries ago. A catastrophe that, thanks to the very low population density of the affected areas and the slow speed at which news spread at that time, was soon forgotten by everyone, including the central government, which even neglected to provide aid to the survivors. But all of this concerns the past. If we want to come to terms with the present, we must get used to the idea that seismic activity in that area still exists, that it has never stopped. And in the meantime, the overall population of those places has risen to 5 million individuals. It would be an apocalypse if the earthquakes of 1811-1812 were to repeat themselves today, don't you think? And all it takes is a simple calculation to understand it. If 2 centuries ago the percentage of casualties compared to the population was 7%, not counting the losses suffered by the natives, which are difficult to calculate, with an earthquake of the same power, we should expect at least 300,000 deaths today. A massacre. But is the New Madrid fault still active and high risk for the population? At the beginning of the 20th century, the area began to attract numerous scientific expeditions, with throngs of geologists eager to understand what could have caused such intense earthquakes in a region where there were no surface faults like California's San Andreas. After decades of excavations and studies, it was understood that the seismic activity of New Madrid is not due to the tug-of-war between 2 antagonistic tectonic plates, as usually happens in the overwhelming majority of violent seismic events. The critical zone, in fact, is not located on the edge of a plate, but near the center of the North American plate, buried 600 to 900 meters deep under thick fluvial sediments. It should not be surprising, even if areas far from the plate margins are occasionally hit by earthquakes. Even the largest and most stable plates, where geological movements ended billions of years ago, can sometimes undergo internal deformation, mainly determined by the pressures exerted on their edges. Another theoretical reason for the development of interplate earthquakes could be the birth of a new margin, namely a new rift zone due to the separation of a plate into two distinct plates, and this seems to be the most likely case for New Madrid. It is estimated that 0.5% of the seismic energy released in the world is attributable to earthquakes that originate away from plate boundaries. The remaining 99.5% is due to those more numerous and stronger that occur along the margins between plates. In the case of New Madrid, it also happens that the harder, colder, drier, and less fractured crust of the central United States can generate shocks over larger areas compared to earthquakes of comparable magnitude that occur in the West. The geological structure of the New Madrid fault zone is indeed composed of layers of sedimentary rock, such as limestone, which spreads and amplifies the shocks, just like hitting a bass drum. Due to this chain effect, an earthquake along the New Madrid fault zone would travel farther and cause more damage than a similar magnitude earthquake on the West Coast. Today, the New Madrid fault zone, which is active, holds the highest seismic risk in North America east of the Rocky Mountains. Currently, an average of 200 earthquakes occur in New Madrid each year, most of which, however, are too small to be felt. About once a year, there is an earthquake of magnitude 3.0, and about once every 10 years, there is an earthquake of magnitude 5.0 or higher. Earthquakes cannot be predicted. The likelihood or probability can be calculated from recurrence models in the past. Based on evidence of seismic activity found in geological features, scientists estimate that in New Madrid, an earthquake with a magnitude greater than 7.5 on the Richter scale could occur every 200 to 300 years. Seismologists also calculated 25 to 40% probability of another severe earthquake, 6.0 or higher, occurring in the New Madrid seismic zone by 2040, with significant damage and loss of life. One day, perhaps without any warning, an absolutely massive earthquake will strike the New Madrid fault. When that happens, thousands of Americans will die, tens of thousands of structures will be completely destroyed, and millions of people will be left homeless. This would be a nightmare from which none of us could wake up. So since we don't know when the big event might come, the best thing to do is to prepare, imposing extreme safety measures across the entire territory. Unfortunately, we know that very little has been done about it by the authorities, and this certainly does not leave us feeling reassured. For its part, the small town of New Madrid, now taken as a symbol of earthquake risk in the region, now has a population of 3,000. And reportedly tends to take it very philosophically, content, as some say, to keep one eye on the Mississippi and one on the hills. New Madrid folk singer Lou Hobbs put it another way in his signature song, Living on the New Madrid Fault Line. The good Lord, he puts us all here, and only he's going to take us away. Living on the New Madrid Fault Line, you gotta live it day by day.